Good afternoon, South Africa, and welcome to a Friday afternoon edition of Afternoon Express. Bonnie and myself are very excited for today's show because it's going to be such a mixed bag, and we can't wait to share it with you and get ready for the weekend. Coming up on the show today, we keep the spirit of Madiba alive with some incredibly talented young acts who are doing South Africa really, really proud. One of those acts is Lasandra. She's a 15-year-old singer who recently had the chance to represent the continent in New York at the Go Africa Harlem Music Festival.
Absolutely, and we also chat to the founders of Vula Youth Development, an after-school project that focuses on the empowerment of youth from historically disadvantaged communities. They'll be giving us a special performance in
Indeed.
The loft.
Indeed. Now, if you guys caught last night's episode of Presenter Search on 3, you'll know that after the massive twist, Shannon and Peelo were eliminated, and we were obviously got them live in the loft with us today to talk through their experiences thus far. Such a sad sort of exit.
It's always such heartbreaking. Talents. It's always
at that point of the game, yeah.
Absolutely, because they made it really far. And our first guest, though, is a formidable young political figure, Lindiwe Mazibuko, former leader of the opposition in parliament, has a passion for getting more young people involved in politics, and she's founded the Apolitical Academy that aims to train and mentor young people. Welcome to the loft. Lovely
Thank
to
you.
Have you here.
Thanks for inviting me.
Yeah, we have been waiting and waiting and waiting to get you on this couch to have this conversation. You're probably South Africa's favorite sort of political figure, and I think you've just managed to transcend through the talk and just focus on the doing, and we've just loved that.
Thank you.
Why the name apolitical?
It's a lot of things. It's primarily a statement of who we are. In other words, we don't have any ideological affiliation organizationally, but it's also a conversation starter, right? What does it mean to be nonpartisan? So what we want to do is build a program that's actually multi-partisan, where there's lots of different views in the room. Each cohort of 25 fellows will either be without ideology or have, you know, very competing ideologies, and it'll give them a chance to defend their ideas, talk about their ideas, learn how to climb down from a position that's not a big deal, or to stick to their guns on something that's principled.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's an experience that most political training programs don't give to young aspirant leaders.
Well, when there is political training even.
Yeah.
So I find that as a young person in this country, if you're politically inclined or you're even entertaining the idea of going into public service, it seems that the first port of call is to make, like, form allegiance with a party before you even have an idea of the kind of service
you want to
contribute or provide.
Yeah.
And that's problematic, I find.
100%.
How can we help young people see politics in a more constructive way?
Yeah, I mean, a friend of mine likened it to the other day to learning not law, but how a specific law firm operates, right?
Yeah.
Or
yeah.
learning medicine, not medicine, but how, you know, one specific hospital operates.
So accurate, yeah.
So it's the same problem. And look, there's a hugely important place for internal party political training programs. I played a big part in the DA's internal political party training program when I was leading that party in parliament. But what I've learned since stepping back from politics is that the limitations of programs like this, and they need to be complemented by a kind of citizen-led movement. Where we don't just leave it to political parties to choose who the next generation of leaders are going to be, but actually as citizens we fund, support, build, you know, capable young people to become future public leaders. And, you know, the great benefit is you don't have to say up front before you apply to our program, this is what political party I support. You don't even have to know or be able to identify an ideological background. You just have to care about people. You want to, you know, want to serve people. Mm. You have to have a track record in leadership, one that we can identify and see what the impact was, and a real passion to be ethical, transformational, and representative.
I also just don't like this narrative that politics is parliament. I mean, it's not always the same thing. There's a lot of, like, sort of, you know, public service that goes on outside of just the parliament room and, you know, the chaos that can unfold in those spaces.
Yeah.
What do you define as public service? I mean, and what is the academy actually going to feed?
So, I mean, for me, public service covers everything in the public sector. So anything that comes from public money, public funding, so be that government, national, local, and provincial government, or government institutions, government businesses like Eskom, the SABC, anything that touches the private sector, the public sector, my apologies. I have a firm belief that government is probably the single biggest lever for change.
Yeah.
You know, the annual budget is over a trillion rand now, annually. That's the kind of resources that as taxpayers we give to, you know, the state to change people's lives, to make the country better, to grow the economy. And so, you know, if you serve in public service, or you've been outside lobbying, you know, to try and get change, transitioning into the public service is a real opportunity to get in on the decision making. So it's not just that we want people to serve in parliament, but we want them to have real access to power. You know, we want to treat young people as responsible enough to have a healthy desire to attain and gain the power to change the society that they live in. Instead of sitting back and always, you know, marching on parliament, you know, as part of the Fees Must Fall movement, or marching, you know, towards government buildings
being on
to get legislative change. Exactly. Yeah. And the truth is, the people that we march to, or that young people march to when they're protesting, are not going to be in power forever. So the question is, who is going to replace them, and what are young people doing to turn their activism into practical ideas for how to implement budgets, make difficult decisions, change policy, write laws?
I don't know where the entry points are. I don't think young people know where the entry points are.
No, I think people think it's more complicated than it is. I mean,
although the entry point is service.
Well, the entry point, I mean, in terms of, you know, getting a job is filling in an application form, right?
Right.
So
right.
People assume that, you know, to run for office, it's much more opaque and murky, like you've got to wear a hood and chant something.
Yeah.
But actually, it's almost the same, right? You most political parties take applications. We're about to go into a list process for all the political parties now. The IEC is going to require them to submit lists. So some people will form parties, others will join parties, but, you know, people will have to run for a position on the party list. That's if you run for elected office. The other side is, once people have won elections, a mayor or a premier will then need to build a staff, a private office staff.
Right.
And often they lack the technical capacity to implement really frontier challenging policy, like climate change, resilience policy, things like this, smart cities. And so one of the things we're hoping to do is get people in the private sector who've got that kind of technical capacity to lend their advisory chops to the government, right? So that we're not only reliant on political hacks like myself, right, to make serious technical decisions. There's a role for politics and for maneuvering through the system, but there's also a role for technical advice that enables ministers and mayors to make quality decisions.
And it's an opportunity for active citizenship.
Absolutely, absolutely. And look, active citizenship can mean a lot of things. You know, my great hope is that more people will run for office. I really get sad when people talk about how dirty politics is. It doesn't have to be, or how slow and, you know, useless government is. It doesn't have to be. And in fact, there are good people in both, in politics and in government. So as an organization, we want to snowball the effect of the good people and, in a sense, cycle out the dysfunctional people. But the only way to do that is to encourage people to make that first step. And we want to start by giving them the tools in terms of personal development and then pointing them in the right direction and getting them mentorship, crucially, so that they survive that journey.
I think you guys are pretty inspired at the moment. And if you are, all the details on how to get involved, we'll have to share with you in just a bit. Because remember to head over to our social sites at the moment, Afternoon Chat on Twitter and Afternoon Express on Facebook. And let us know what inspired you this week. It's Afternoon Chat on Twitter. And you don't forget to use the hashtag across all the platforms, Afternoon Express.
Absolutely. And we'll be back with more from Lindiwe Mazibuko after the break. So stay right there. Welcome back to Afternoon Express, live on SABC3, and we're back on the couch with the formidable Lindiwe Mazibuko. Let's chat a little bit about your tenure in the DA. During your tenure, I felt that the media singled you out, or perhaps other political figures singled you out as a voice that could be undermined because you were a privileged black female, because politics in our country has a struggle phase. Mm-hmm. And if you don't fit into that bracket, then we don't want to hear from you. How do you feel about that?
I mean, it's interesting. I hate that I had to go through it. Mm-hmm. But in fact, when I got to the States, I met a lot of young people from Ghana, from Nigeria, from Zimbabwe, whose parents had emigrated to the US before they were born or when they were very young, and who had grown up there, and who are like, I want to go home and serve. But like you, I'm worried that people are going to say, what's that accent about? Mm. Or you're not a real African. Mm. But having seen your experiences, I feel like maybe I can give it a bash. How should I do it? Mm. So I think it was awful to live through, you know, but I guess maybe, you know, sometimes we must live through these things so other people can see that we can survive them. Yeah. And that it's okay to be yourself in politics. I think one of the things that was strange about people's obsession with my accent was that they
their obsession with you in general. Oh, I mean, no. I think people are quite obsessed with you.
I would get accused of not speaking Zulu to people who never listened to any Zulu stations. So they'd be like, why have we never heard you speak Zulu? I'd be like, well, tune into a Zulu language station and you'll hear it. Don't ask me on CNN. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right, so that was a challenge. Look, I think one of the things as a young democracy we have to get right is how to let people be themselves, how not to box people, how not to have competitions about who's black enough, who's female enough, who's male enough or whatever, and how to just let people represent the ideas they care about and inhabit the skin they're in an authentic way. Mm. And one of the things I'm really excited about doing when we do our campaign classes at Apolitical Academy is letting our fellows push the boundaries of their identity in a sense, not try to imitate other politicians, not try to be somebody else, but actually lean into how young they are, what country they were born in, what issues they care about and why, as opposed to thinking of politics as something, you know, that has a particular face and a tie and a certain kind of wardrobe. And I think once we do that, we'll have this really vibrant,
democracy. Was it tough to leave a party that you had believed in for so long?
Well, I never left the party. I left public office, right? Mm-hmm. I resigned from parliament. I mean, I was re-elected and then I resigned. Mm-hmm. And I did it because I did it for a lot of reasons, but they were all primarily reasons that were about me. Mm. I needed to take care of myself. Yeah. I mean, you rightly point out that I was a lightning rod for everybody's issues, right? Whether it was about my gender or my age, whether it was internal to the party or external to the ruling party, whether it was in the media or outside the media. Mm. Like, so I kind of felt like in a very short time I had taken on a lot, and at some point the negativity and the stress was beginning to get to me. Like, I had insomnia, you know, and my skin was always breaking out for no reason. Like, crazy stuff was happening to me. So I also thought about the long term, right? I thought, if I burn out now, what service will I have done in my country? You know, what exciting opportunities to serve in government or to have, a long and industrious career will I have sacrificed by burning out early? So a lot of it was about, you know, me taking care of myself. And it was the best decision I've ever made. Yeah, right? And it was hard because I think a lot of people felt like it was quite a shocking thing to do, especially when my career was hitting quite a stride. But I think even sometimes when people can't understand why you've taken a difficult decision, if you have enough people around you to talk through it, eventually it makes sense. And I think for a lot of people now it makes sense, the reason that I did this. And I'm really glad that I
did. Exactly. Yeah. So are we, because I mean, now you're letting the future generation of sort of these leaders be taught and learn and grow in that space. You mentioned something else that was quite interesting about sort of gender and race and politics. And I feel like the media plays quite a big role in that, because I feel I am at arm's length away from all politicians because I only get told through the lens of the media. Is what we're being shared through in the media what's actually happening inside? And is it a prettier picture? Is it something that young people should be excited to do, is politics?
So one of the things that's always bugged me is political violence is still a problem in this country. I don't think it's reported on in the way that it should be. It happens in devastating numbers. People die, their houses are burned down, they're beaten, they're stabbed over their political affiliation. And usually that's a proxy for, you took my position as a mayor or as a councillor or whatever. Sure. But one of the things people don't know is that MPs in particular are very friendly behind the scenes. Mm. That Parliament is theatre, and that what happens in the House needn't be replicated outside. That, you know, you can fight with people and have a cigarette with them in the courtyard. Mm. I shouldn't be talking about smoking, because don't smoke, guys. Or have a drink with them in the bar, or whatever it is, right?
So I can't encourage that either, but okay.
But it makes me sad that people would put their lives on the line for what they believe are life and death issues. And it's one of the things that came to me when I went to an ANC meeting. So I've been hanging out with the ANC and a lot of other political parties, the UDM, COPE, but it's the ANC that attracts all the attention.
Glad everyone's getting along.
It's the ANC that attracts all the attention. And I'm doing it because I need a place for my fellows to network into if they choose to run in the ANC, right?
That's wise,
So it's important for me to play open cards with all political parties, which is what we're doing, and to talk to potential supporters, mentors, people who come and teach, get to know the class, and then, you know, potentially support them in their political careers. So, but what's kind of slightly taken me aback is how people are almost like, have you changed religion? Have you converted to, you know, are you joining the... So I think one of the things we need to sort of start to do as we consolidate our democracy is start to think of political parties just as political parties. And politicians just as politicians. It's not a life or death thing. We're not in the middle of a revolution. You know, nobody is being sent, you know, arrested willy-nilly. Journalists are not being jailed, you know. These things are happening in other parts of our region, but they're not happening here. And so to treat politics like it's life or death, or like it's a blood pact, you know, my blood is blue, my blood is, well, all our blood is red, my blood is black,
green,
and gold.
Else,
that's crazy. You can support a party and then you can withdraw your support from a party, and that's fine. And I think we're starting to move into that, but I think the sight of politicians being friendly with each other is something, it's like, it's the last taboo, I think. So I'm interested in ways that we can do that, because I hope one day, if we are developing and, in a sense, not educating, but helping support the next generation of leaders on a non-partisan basis, they will go out into the world and they'll see each other across the aisle. And how will they behave towards each other? Will they fight on the basis of personality, or will they be like, you know what, I actually know you're a human being. I've experienced you outside this context. And we can, you know, sit in committee and we can work on ideas and we can do the theatre of parliament in parliament, but then we can also smile and be, you know, we've got to find a way to be congenial in politics. And I think once we can do that, I think it will break down a lot of these ideas about how public office and politics and public service are life and death.
This academy is going to change this landscape. It really is.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. Congratulations. On
That's my great hope.
So please do go and find the application details. They are not closed yet. They've extended the application process thus far. So if you're still somebody who's interested in this kind of a scenario, please go find the details online. Oh, after the break, we're in the kitchen with our guest chef. Hope joins us, and he's making some clover amasi, macadamia, and cranberry fudge. Plus, we meet Lasandra, the 15-year-old singer who is making South Africa proud.
One, two, one, two. Masi is a thick, creamy mass your family will love. Made with love by Clover.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express. We're live on SABC3 on this Friday afternoon. Can you believe it's the weekend? We've got something sweet to make you in the kitchen today. With its creamy texture and rich flavor, Clover Amasi is perfect to use in cooking, baking, and can also be used in another dish. Today we're making a macadamia and cranberry fudge. It's the most delicious recipe, and if you want it, you SMS the keyword Clover to 33650 at a cost of R1.50. And all the lists of ingredients will be sent directly to your mobile device. Remember, those SMSs are charged at R1.50 and no free SMSs apply. I'm so excited to cook alongside you because you always make the most delicious treats. And I'm so excited to see that we're making fudge.
Thank you. Thank you for giving me such compliments. So today I'm doing something so different with Amasi. I'm actually used to it in pap and bread and all that. But today I'm making fudge.
Lekker. Let's get started. So I want to see how you do it.
Okay, so I melt the butter in here. All right, we're going to add the sugar.
Oh, the hero ingredient.
Yeah.
Any kind of sugar?
Caster sugar.
Okay, so you want the finer sugar.
Yeah.
Got you.
And then we're going to add some honey in here. Ooh, can I have a pinch of salt as well in here?
Oh, yes.
Yay.
I see we're using fancy, I don't know, salt from some hill and
it's
some...
salt flakes, nothing fancy.
How much do
you want? Yeah, that's enough, because we're going to put on top when we're finished.
A little bit of extra, you never know.
All right, so we need to stir everything together. All right, so the whole idea is to make it cook, all right? And you need to get it to 115.
115 degrees. Yeah, 115. How do you know when it gets degrees. There? Just stick a thermometer inside.
Yeah. Okay. So let me put the Amasi in here as well.
Cool, you can carry on stirring because I can't do two things at once. Tell me how much you want.
Yeah, go, put. Yeah, who would have thought that Amasi would do fudge, eh?
Who would have thought? Because it's almost got like a slightly sort of soury taste, if you imagine.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
I'm guessing the
yeah.
sugar and the honey, it's sweeten it up.
Mm-hmm.
And it's almost got like, I can imagine with the macadamias and the cranberry in there, you've also got that little bit of sour and sweet thrown in as well. Say when?
Nice, perfect.
Cool. Sorry, I splashed everywhere.
Yeah. I can see the mess that you made.
You've got to enjoy cooking. If it's not messy, it means you're not having fun, right?
All right. So if you're going to stay, all right? And then we need to cook it until it's 115. Use a sugar thermometer.
Okay.
Or not, the trick is use cold water, right? Ice cold water. Put a drop in it. If it seizes and thickens, then it's perfect.
That is the worst thing for me. If you guys have ever made fudge before, you'll know what I'm talking about. That softball stage, no one even knows what that means. You drop it in the water. Yes, that looks right. How do you know?
Come on, you'll see it. It becomes a small
crystal. The thermometer's
crystal.
Better. Your solution of the thermometer works much better.
All right. And then when you're done, all right, you pour it in there.
Yeah. Please make sure you keep your kids away from this process, guys, because at that temperature, that like kind of heat, you really do not want to have kids burning themselves because sugar, when it heats up, is really, really hot.
Yeah. So from there, we need to beat it up until it's cold, all right, and thick and matte.
Cold and thick and matte.
Yeah, that's the perfect fudge. Then when you're done from there,
it's like every girl's worst nightmare. Boyfriend whose name is Matt, he's like thick and he's cold, you know?
So here I've got cranberries, I've got macadamias.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to add some thyme in here. And you can do anything at home. Like you can make it peanuts.
Almonds.
Make it almonds. Do whatever you want. Put some orange zest in it.
Cool.
You know?
Play around with it. Hoid into your actual batter itself to make sure it combines.
Yeah, and then mix it up together. And then into your lined baking pan. All right.
Good job.
From there, put it aside for an hour to set.
And it sets coming out looking like that?
Yep.
Dude.
Yep. And then what you can do at home, look in this jar.
Oh, wow. He's taken a little bit of wax wrapping as well and wrapped them up nicely.
Nice. Clover Amasi.
I like cooking with this dude. He's probably my favorite chef in the kitchen. Second to Clem, obviously. We love Clem more than anyone else that's been on the show. It's good to have you, dude.
Took your spot, Clem.
It certainly is really simple. Honestly, guys, it was really easy to make. I even managed to do this. If I can, you can too. SMS the keyword Clover to 33650 to get this recipe sent to you. It'll cost you R1.50 and your free SMSs don't apply. And if you need a little reminding on exactly what we did, here's a quick recap. Thank you.
with Love by Clover.
Welcome back. Now, July is Madiba month. As we continue to celebrate his legacy and the values he stood for, we're joined now by Lasandra, a 15-year-old super talented singer who recently traveled to New York to perform at the Go Africa Harlem Music Festival. Welcome to The Loft, Lasandra.
Thank you so much.
You look
thank
absolutely you. Gorgeous. Lovely thank to you. Have thank you, you here. Thank you. So how was New York? You toured New York and you performed at the Go yes. Harlem Festival?
Yes, it was a great experience, and I'm only 15 years old, and it was a very, very big place, and you know, it's a busy place,
busy.
And
it's alive.
Yeah, huh? And you get a lot of energy, yeah.
Absolutely. So you started singing when you were four?
Yeah, at my grandparents' anniversary. Yeah.
Wow, and you always just knew that this is what you wanted to do. So you're going to perform a track for us called Magodi, which is quite a grown subject for a 15-year-old girl. Why?
No, by the way, Lindiwe wrote the song for me, and they wanted me to sing it. So I did. And I don't relate to it, but I can feel like it relates to females who are ready to get married and start a family. So,
yeah. We were chatting a little bit during the break, and you want to study further after high school.
Yes.
And one day you want to have a PhD in music.
Yes, girl. And in drama.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, good luck with that, and congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Once again.
Thank you.
So, take it away.
Thank you.
Yeah.
We have got such talent in our country, and clearly we are in safe hands. After the break, we turn our attention to present a search on three. Last night, in a massive twist, Shannon and Peelo were eliminated, and they'll be joining us on the couch to chat about their experience. Don't go anywhere.
Clover Amasi is a thick, creamy mass your family will love. Made with love by Clover.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express. Now, on last night's episode of Presenter Search on 3, the contestants were challenged with a top billing takeover and given their very own segment to present. And at the end of the episode, two contestants were eliminated from the competition. Let's have a look at that surprise moment.
This is the end of the journey for you, Shannon, and for you, Peelo.
No!
Tabby, so you're still safe.
What a tough moment. What a tough moment, guys. Welcome. Lovely to have
you. Thank you to have us.
Tell us about that surprise double elimination.
Oh,
whew, let me catch my breath. Actually, because every time...
That's actually the first time we've seen
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
We were actually in a plane yesterday.
You're tearing up again.
I am.
Yeah, it's emotional.
I am, but yeah, it is. It is. It really is. But in that moment, even when they announced that it's going to be like a double elimination, you still think that it can't be you. You know, so for me, for my light to go off, and unfortunately, Shannon tried to hug me in that moment, I just wanted to get out of the room and breathe.
Why did you leave the room?
Because I just figured, like, I have no... I don't know. I needed to breathe. I needed to escape. I needed to think. I needed to collect myself. It was just, like, an instinct to just leave, you know?
To find safety.
Just, yeah.
Yeah.
And I just, like, belted when I got out of the room and just let it all...
Let it all out. And yourself, Shannon, how did you feel?
I almost had, like, a mathematical reaction in the sense, and this might be controversial, me and Sabiso were both in the bottom three before, and Peelo was never there. So I was thinking, and I was looking down at the spots, and I was expecting the light to my right to stay on. And that's why you saw my reaction. It was very genuine, because even before I was telling Peelo, there's no way you're going home, because she hasn't been in the bottom three before. So I was shocked. Maybe, I thought maybe I can go home, no worries, I messed up. But Peelo, I was devastated. Yeah.
How do you feel about making it this far? I mean, it's a huge achievement.
It is a huge achievement, and I don't think, you know, even though we didn't win, we can't take away from the fact that we came this far. But it's you have to take it with a grain of salt, because it's like, okay, you may not have won, but you still, like, were able to, you know, make an impact in South African, you know, television, and were able to still be passionate and get this far and, you know, win, essentially, because even though you didn't win a specific job, you won someone over, and they're probably going to call and be like, actually, you're perfect for what we want you to do.
Yeah. I mean, some of the criticism was that you guys don't take direction well, or that you don't listen. What are your thoughts on that?
I'll answer that.
just because I sent some spice.
So before the spice lands, for me, I don't mind that criticism, because I'm 22, I'm a zygote, I'm presenting. So for me, this whole...
a zygote.
A little baby zygote. For me, it was... Wah, wah, wah. Like, I was taking everything in. So maybe that maybe looks a little bit distracting at times, but for me, I was just so happy to be here, because, I mean, if you look at the maths, 6,000 people down to 8, it's 0.01%. Mm. So even though maybe I didn't do as well as I could have, I had so much fun doing it. Yeah. And that's what I'll focus on.
And yourself, Peelo?
My criticism was, I felt it was a bit weird for me to listen to, because essentially it was, I'm too perfect and perfect can get boring. But I think what was misunderstood was that I'm not putting on this person that I think they think I'm putting on. I'm just naturally like that. And I think because it's a difficult mold to break, because it's who I am, you know, it touched them or rubbed them the wrong way. So yeah, it was weird for me to hear that criticism, honestly.
Yeah, it triggered some people.
A lot of people.
It triggered a lot of people.
Twitter is blowing up right now. It's ridiculous.
Well, you know, I think the presenting platform, or being a host on any show, will always bring criticism. Everybody has an opinion of who they think they are or who you are, and it's just what comes with the game and the territory. And you guys, having learned everything that you've learned, what do you think you're going to do with this experience now?
I think for me, like, I can only want to... Actually, I have this incredible analogy that I use when I describe my experience or what I felt during the competition, because I prayed every single day for an opportunity like this. So I think what God was essentially showing me was that you want this incredible table, right? But I want to give you the tools to make your own table. Mm. So moving forward, I want to be more involved in what television looks like, and not essentially just come in at the end as like a face to just like speak, but actually like be involved and actually create the content that I want to be a part of. So that's the only... Be my own Basizana Khumalo. Be my own Patience Stevens.
Yeah. And yourself?
Could you repeat the question again?
After this whole experience and everything that you've learned, what do you want to do with it going forward?
I think for me personally, what I realized, and I said it this morning on Expresso, which is obviously the show that I loved, even though this is a great show as well. what I realized is that there's
a little bit of spoils,
but there is a show for everyone. And for me, what I learned mostly was about myself and about my personality. And for some people that doesn't work, and for other people,
It does work. So going forward from now, I'm going to do presenting, radio, YouTube channel, everything I can, but still acting is my home. So I love going into different characters because then you lose that criticism of really be yourself and when you fall. So that's what I will go back to, theatre every single time, because there you can really just let go, which is
absolutely
so much fun.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, as an actress myself, I find being a TV host or a presenter far more vulnerable because I'm always bringing myself in. Anybody can say anything about that self, but when I'm lost in a character, I'm hiding in the character.
Absolutely.
And it's fun, it's freeing.
It's fun, it's lovely. It's both are lovely and both have their merits. But thank you so much. Congratulations again for making it this far. You guys were extraordinary.
Yeah, well done.
Thank you
very
much.
This is not the last time we're seeing you on
the
screen.
We're also a couple. We just want to announce that.
I'm joking.
You found solace in each other's arms. So don't forget to catch the next episode of Presenter Search on 3 next Thursday, the 19th of July at 7:30 p.m. on SABC 3. And after the break, we're joined by the founders of Vula Youth Development, an after-school program aimed at disadvantaged youth.
Well, welcome back to Afternoon Express on this Friday afternoon. We're live on SABC 3. Now, in the spirit of Madiba, in the month of July, we focus on individuals and organizations that live up to his vision. Vula Youth Development is a leadership and life skills program done through performing arts and creative dialogue facilitation. We're joined now by co-founders Vusumzi as well as Peter, along with Azile, who is one of the recipients and participants of the program itself. Welcome to the loft, you three.
Thank you.
So I see there's a whole crew ready to get ready with the performance later on. But I thought I'd start with you, Vusumzi. Just tell me a little bit more about the program and why it is that you decided to bring music into the space, music and dance and that whole expression.
Okay, first of all, my background is performing arts, specifically African percussion and dance. And I've also done a lot of productions internationally and also locally, including community work. And in 2014, when I just recently came from an international production, you know, I saw a need in my community, you know, because young people lacked positive role models. Mm. And even when you Google Nyanga, what you see, you see Mayor Capital. So they lacked a positive role model. So I decided to start this initiative, you know, using performing arts and also our methodology, not only just performing arts. We use performing arts to bring topics alive, you know, topics that affect young people, you know, on a daily basis.
Yeah.
And also we use the creative dialogue in exploring those topics and making sure that they make informed choices.
I enjoy that. And music obviously is quite a broad spectrum of things. I mean, everyone has their own individual subjective tastes. And I'm quite interested to hear that a man who's been traveling around the world wants to explore South African instruments like the way that you have, as though there's a sort of archetype or stereotype of South African music. Yeah. Why this particular style?
Yeah, basically this specific style of music, it is music that they can relate to on a daily basis because it's close to their hearts, close to their home. And also it's unlike maybe most young people are influenced by American music and all that. So this is more like bringing up their South African culture. Yeah,
I love that. Peter, and there's a whole other big sort of voice behind this, which is young people don't feel like they have permission to speak half the time. And they feel like they're being sort of suppressed in their ideas and thoughts. And part of what you guys are doing is trying to eliminate that.
Well, a very big aspect of what we're trying to do is really to get young people confident in speaking up, right? And performing arts really, really helps. It helped me find my voice, to hide behind an instrument first on stage, but then later getting more confident in speaking up and seeing young people that some weeks, months ago were rather shy in beginning, and seeing them being more and more themselves and feeling more proud and more confident in then not only in the program and in the music and on stage, but in all sorts of life events. That's really what gets me ticking and gets me excited being part of it.
I'm sure, and you guys run the same kind of like sort of workshopping for corporates and government institutions to teach them that as well, and that's how you fund the project.
Well, we've recently started Vula Youth Development. The youth group is older, but we started that as a vehicle, and that we see it as a social enterprise. So the methodology we use with the youth is drumming, music, dance, rhythmic exercises, and facilitated dialogue to create a safe space and to create a connection between young people. Everyone can relate to music. Everyone is connected through music. And in that way, we managed to bring some life skill topics alive that young people would maybe not normally speak about on their own. It takes a bit of a safe space and trust to relaxation of oneself to get there. So in that sense, the same methodology, the way we want to raise funds or the way we want to finance ourselves is not necessarily fundraising or donations, but offering these services to corporates.
I see. That's a really cool way to kind of fund it because it's kind of got the same sort of focus, and I love that. And so good for you guys to talk about it, but it's important to hear from the youth as well, to hear about their experiences, because it's all good and well trying, but are you achieving that sort of impact? And so I'm keen to hear, what was your life like beforehand and sort of how this process has helped you?
I was doing nothing, sitting at home, but I heard about the project, so I started the project in 2016. And it was so fun for me because I love dancing, but I didn't know how to dance.
I don't, so that's something we don't have in common. Yeah.
So I started dancing, and now I love dancing. It's my passion.
Yeah.
I think I want to be a dancer when I grow up. And when I started there, I was very scared. I was not confident. But we get used to each other. And when I started there was a performance in Zolanse and in our community. I was very scared because I didn't even know how to dance. But I get used to that and I did well and we even won.
Sure. It's amazing to hear from you yourself because you said you were a very shy and sort of timid and scared person, and now you're this yes gal, get on stage and get dancing. So it's exciting to see, and I thought we could talk about it as much as we want to, but it's important to show South Africa the work that you guys are doing. So exclusively for you guys right here on Afternoon Express, an exclusive performance for your Friday afternoon. Ladies and gents, take it away. Thank you.
guys have had such extraordinary journeys in the last while. And anyone watching at home who wants to be where you are, what would you say to them?
Actually, get up and go. I think a lot of people think that you have to spend time planning and thinking and, you know, putting this and this together. But if you actually stand up and take that first step, you realize that the next 50 steps are a lot more easier to walk than if you just sat home and thought, I need to take 50 steps to get to where I need to get.
Wow.
All I could say is that follow your dreams, never stop, don't give up, be passionate in something that you want to be, and if you're determined in something, don't stop, just work hard and have patience, because patience is one of the strongest tool that you need to have and in your mind, because I wouldn't be here if I wasn't patient, you know.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, we've run out of time.
I have such a good question. I like answer that though, because can I just like, quickly?
No, but you can Insta story it and post it on After the Express's Insta stories. Deal?
Okay. 100%.
Good night, South Africa. Happy eating.
Love by Clover. Another feel-good production.